kings, queens, nerds, and geeks. Powdered Milk here, and welcome back to Fallout Equestria. This blind commentary today, I have to admit, I feel quite stupid. I don't know if there'll be comments after before this video comes up, because I recorded this after I found this out, because I will apologize. KCat, the one I made a shout out to yesterday, according to this video, it'll be yesterday, but it's directly afterwards for me, but the point of the matter is, I'd like to apologize. I didn't realize you were the person who uploaded this video, this fanfiction. I apologize. I feel stupid. Because I actually, a while back, I tried reading the fanfiction aloud, and I didn't work out. Oh, and that was just like the beginning of it. So now I'm just sitting here feeling stupid. Oh my god. Well, anyway, we're welcome back to the blind commentary of Fallout Equestria. And I'll be honest right here, I forgot to wear pants, and I'm just sitting here not wearing pants, about to listen to this awesome story. And I just couldn't wait to do it after I found out, KCat, that you published it. And thank you so much, because this is an amazing story. And whatever help that you've had, Ed, to make this story, thank them too. Damn. And I don't know if you did this story or not. I don't know if you actually had someone read this story for you or whatever. I love it, and that's that. So anyway, back to the story at hand. We have like an hour to listen to this, so I'm going to have to try to do this as much as I can. This is going to be a very, very long video. So, also, I hope you guys like my little setup I have for this video, the little pit looking out into the distance. And you have my pre-war posters down there. I love them. I depicted them based on what I heard in the story. Like, the VG Pinky is always watching you. We have the Wipe the Stripes poster and the War, Fear, and Death things. These are based on things I think I've heard before. I'm not sure. But here we are. We're going to listen to Calamity, I think.
Alive. I was still alive. As consciousness came back to me, I found myself laying on a mattress, with blankets tucked about me, feeling warm and rested, and far more comfortable than I had since before I left Stable 2 3 days ago. At least, I thought it was 3 days ago. I had no idea how long I'd been unconscious. By habit, I lifted up my forehoof to check the date and time on my pip buck. Doing so unsettled the blanket, which proceeded to slide to the floor. "Oh, look who's awake!" The pretty voice of a mare awfully close to me shocked me into full alertness. Looking up and about, I found myself surrounded by several ponies, only one of which I recognized. And that was the Pegasus who shot me in the first place. I wondered if I was his prisoner. The voice had come from an equally pretty, white-coated earth pony, whose cotton-candy pink mane matched the pink and yellow-striped nurse's dress she was wearing. Scanning what I could see of the walls through the small crowd of ponies, I saw a line of three medical boxes, all the little pink butterflies perfectly in a row, and a faded pre-war poster apparently advertising jobs in healthcare services. "You don't need to be a Steel Ranger to be a hero. Join the Ministry of Peace today," announced the mayor on the poster, barely more than a filly, who wore the exact same dress that I saw brought to life before me. Between the decor and the lack of ropes or chains, I concluded this was a clinic, and I was not a captive. Besides, I was actually feeling quite good. Tired, almost like I needed a good nap. Except I wasn't sleepy. Just tired and kind of warm. I sat up, and the room spun. "Take it easy there, partner," the Pegasus, whose name I recalled was Calamity, although I was a bit fuzzy on how I had learned that, said, stepping towards me. I scooted back on the mattress. Oh, sure, he looked polite and gentle now with all these ponies around. But I had seen when he was all murder from above, guns blazing, death Pegasus.
"Candy?"
One of the other ponies, a gray-coated earth pony with a black mane and tail, asked as he looked to my nurse. Although to me it sounded like he was calling her Candy, and I felt an oddly cheerful urge to agree. Oh, she'll be perfectly fine. I mixed up the last healing potion she needed and gave it to her less than an hour ago.
Mixed?
The Grey Earth Pony raised an eyebrow dubiously. Candy smiled. Why, with apple snaps, of course. I find the medicine always goes down better that way.
I couldn't understand why, the Grey Pony face-hoofed. I felt perfectly fine now. Better than fine. And pleasantly warm.
The Grey Stallion started shooing all of my guests away. That made me feel slightly sad, although I really didn't know any of them. I'd felt so lonely these last few days, so eager to find civilization. And here it was, but he wasn't letting me keep it. A thought which I realized didn't quite make sense, although I wasn't sure why.
Come on out when you're feeling up to it. I know there's some ponies who'd like to see you, the Grey Stallion smiled at me.
Then looked at the rust-colored straggler.
You too, Calamity. Out you go.
Calamity took one look back at me before scooting out. Candy pranced up to me and whispered dreamily,
Such a handsome stallion, isn't he?
Who?
Why, Calamity, of course, she giggled.
I was at a loss for words. No, I wasn't. He shot me. She waved that off with a hoof wiggle.
I'm sure it was just a misunderstanding.
It was, I recall, but why was I having this conversation?
Oh, my,
if anything,
camera's fuzzy.
I wanted to talk about how pretty Candy, not talk about Calamity. Least of all, whether or not he was handsome. None of which seemed to find a suitable way to be spoken aloud. Sulkingly, I fell back on reiterating, He shot me, then added, A lot. More rested and with a much clearer head, I was eager to meet the ponies of New Appaloosa. By my pit buck,
New Appaloosa?
2 days. I gazed over the railing at the walled village. Multiple lines of what I had realized were railroad tracks converged into a town made of largely of dozens upon dozens of virtually identical homes built from old passenger cars, many of them stacked two or three high. Most still had their wheels. Heavy metal boxcars formed a ring around the town, with a massive gate on either side. Armed pony guards walked around the tops of the boxcars, keeping their eyes on the wastes outside. Inside, scores of Earth and Unicorn ponies trotted about their daily lives. The place was dirty, rusty, and altogether wonderful.
How did you get them stacked like that?
I asked, looking up at the stacked train cars, the tallest group being four high. Railing and catwalk spanned out from it, connecting to other towers. On the highest roof, brilliantly glowing letters announced Turnpike Tavern. Railwright, the gray and black stallion who had turned out to be the sheriff-slash-mayor-slash-general hold-togetherer of the town, deadpanned.
Had one of them unicorn ponies do it.
I turned with a gasp, staring at him. I'd never heard of a pony levitating anything that big or heavy before. Railwright held that serious expression just a moment longer before chortling.
I'm just playing with you.
My astonishment faded into a sheepish grin as he smiled and pointed towards the sky behind us.
That's what the crane is for.
Looking back up, I could see the huge orange tower of metal jutting out above the town, a massive hook dangling from its long arm.
Although, he continued, if you're looking for a heavy lifter, you can't do better than Crane. You should talk to him.
Talk to the crane? I said slowly, trying to gauge if this was another joke.
I know what he's saying.
But it wasn't. Crane, he told me, was the name of a unicorn pony who worked in the train yard.
Won't find a better and stronger telekinetic this side of the Candlelot Ruins.
With that, Railroad offered to give me a grand tour.
Telekinetic.
New Appaloosa's general supply store was called Absolutely Everything. It was the fourth stop on the tour. Railroad smiled knowingly as he coaxed me towards the odd-looking building. Three train cars, each a different type, had been fused together to create the store. One of them was a barrel-shaped car of black metal dominated by a smokestack. This was one of the sources of smoke I had seen in the distance. Pausing in front of the door, I read the signs beneath the playful block letters of the store name. Yes, I do deliveries. No hooves, nasty stingers, no service. Ask me about special orders. I won't answer, but I'll get right on it. Wasteland Survival Guide, available now. First copy for every family is free. I pushed the door open and stepped inside, and stopped when I gasped as I saw the zombie pony from the Raider Library. I could tell she was the same one by the way one of her eyes rolled up. The fact that she recognized me with an immediate bright smile and dashed over to give me an uncomfortably squishy hug were admittedly also cues.
She backtrotted and waved the four of about in what was a surprisingly effective combination of welcoming and showing off the store. Something I hated to admit I was thankful for. The stench of her as she hugged me forced me to hold my breath. I had been sure gagging would have been impolite. Hello again? I said, feeling a little awkward.
Is this who I think it is?
Last time Pegasus' zombie pony saw me, I was trotting off to put a bullet in a raider's brain pan. Howdy, said a familiar voice off to my left. I'd been so focused on the zombie pony that I'd totally missed that there were other people in the store. Turning, I found Calamity looking back at me with a bashful smile. Look, before you scamper, I just want to say how sorry I am. I didn't scamper, although I did take a cautious step back. I've been getting the story from Ditsy Doo here, see? Ditsy Doo. I turned to the Pegasus zombie. You
that is.
Wrote the Wasteland Survival Guide?
It is!
Both Ditsy Doo's eyes managed to focus on me, and she was absolutely beaming with joy, nodding fervently. Yes, I do deliveries.
It's Derpy?
Suddenly, I had a very good idea.
One of my favorite ponies? Where's my figurine? I wish.
In turn, fortified my suspicions about the watcher.
I can't find it, but I have it here somewhere.
While I was thinking, Ditsy Doo had rushed up, another copy of the book in her mouth, and was stuffing it into my saddlebags. The zombie pony was amazingly kind and generous, and had a severe problem with personal space. I opened my mouth to say something, maybe that I already had a copy, although considering there had been several pages torn out of the copy on the raider's table, having another could be quite helpful. However, whatever I was about to say got derailed by a strange realization. You don't talk much, do you? Could zombie ponies talk? Ditsy Doo stepped back and opened her muzzle wide, giving me more of a look inside of her mouth than I had ever wanted. Calamity focused my attention. Ditsy Doo's tongue was cut out by slavers a few decades ago. She gets by real well without it, though. So then, Monterey Jack's warning had been cringingly accurate. Ditsy Doo trotted to the sales counter, where she picked up a pencil in her teeth and scribbled something on the first sheet of a large pad of notepaper. She dropped the pencil and held up the notepad, her eye going weird again. Looking strictly at the paper so my gaze didn't rudely follow her eye, I read aloud. Because I couldn't talk, I took up writing. If it hadn't been for that, I would never have gotten so good at it. I looked up at her with a blink. Ditsy Doo put down the pad, picking up the pencil again.
That's pretty awesome.
Before lifting it again for me to read. Now, how about we get you some better armor?
But she wrote the survival guide.
Bottle caps?
Okay. Okay, she wrote the survival guide. That's pretty awesome. Like, because that's actually a reference to an actual mission in the game. If you go to that one store in Megaton, if, like, she gives you a mission to look up stuff and find out things in all throughout the wasteland, and she gives you the Wasteland Survival Guide in return. And I think that's pretty freaking awesome because you learn some amazing new things and stuff, and it's a pretty valuable item, I think. And this is really cool because they actually implemented that particular mission, which probably has already been done, but they have Derpy write it. I know it's Ditsy here, but I call her Derpy because that's how I recognize her. And that's what most people call her. And, you know, that was also her original name in the show. They called her Derpy when she first had a voice. So, let's back to the fan fiction. So,
that's what ponies use for money out here. As absurd as it was, and it was absolutely ludicrous, I should have seen that coming. No wonder the raiders were hoarding the things. No wonder there were empty bottles littered everywhere, but not a bottle cap to be found. Except, of course, for the one I tossed casually away somewhere outside Ironshot Firearms. My stable utility barding was back at absolutely everything. Ditsy Doo didn't have any armor in my size, but she swore she could modify my barding so it was better than the best armor any raider could scrounge together. She offered to do it for free, but I insisted on paying her for work. And that's when I discovered the absolutely cockeyed, no offense to Ditsy, barter system used throughout the equestrian wasteland. Bottle caps. Seriously. Fortunately, pre-war money was still worth something, if only in bulk. If for no other reason than they could get sodas out of the few vending machines that hadn't simply been pried open and raided already. Ditsy Doo took all but a few of my coins. I had no idea if what I'd given her was a fair price, but I suspect I was getting a generous discount. She also insisted on giving me a sheet of paper detailing an entirely different use for bottle caps. a way to turn them into homemade mines.
Oh.
Apparently, it was going to be an insert for the Wasteland Survival Guide's chapter on mines, but some pony wisely discouraged her from including it. When I had left absolutely everything, Railwright commented,
"Ditsidoo's our resident Pegasus, as well as our resident ghoul."
Right, because ghoul pony sounds so much better than zombie pony.
Oh, there goes my phone!
He continued, poking a hoof towards Calamity.
"I keep telling this one he's always welcome to settle down here in my town. He's been keeping the caravan safe going on for 4 years now."
Now, as I was on my way to meet Crane, with Calamity trotting along beside me, I finally ventured conversation with the rust-colored stallion. "So, you don't live here?" "Nope. Got my own place about half an hour's flight distant."
Sorry, I gotta check it real fast.
I thought of what I knew of Pegasus ponies. A place up in the clouds? I could swear
okay, I can't get to it right now, so.
"Oh, no. Just a shack. Something some pony threw together a few generations ago, only to get eaten by wild animals in these here parts." I'd already encountered some of these wild animals in these parts. As we walked down the catwalk, my gaze fell on the strange weapon that Calamity wore, my eyes following from the gun barrels to the odd metal protrusion that stuck out in front of him. A control mechanism, I suspected. I opened my mouth to ask him about it, only to find myself looking at air. I stopped and looked back. He had halted abruptly to let by a mare in a straw sun hat and her colt. The mare was apparently having trouble keeping the colt from dashing off at top speed. She looked like she wanted the leash. "But Ma, I want to go see Derpy." Calamity leaned close and whispered, "That's what some folks call ditsy-do, 'cause the eye." Yeah, that's what they'd focus on. The bullies back in Stable 2 would totally have ignored the whole putrefying flesh thing for that. "She doesn't seem to mind. I actually think she finds it endearing." I didn't point out that Ditsy-Doo didn't seem to mind having her tongue cut out either. Didn't make it right. "Trolley, you get back here," the mother called out as the colt started to trot a little too fast.
That is, "and you stay away from that store. I know
I don't want you bothering that
I call
thing.
Her Derpy because that's what I've always known her as, but..."
Okay, I'll admit, I'd thought of her as an it a few times, but that was back when I thought she was dead. I stopped. "Excuse me, miss, I'm new here. Is there something wrong about ghoul ponies?" The mare looked abashed, staring more at Calamity than me. I didn't need to look. I could feel his scowl. "Well, nothing against good old Derpy. I mean, Miss Ditsy-Doo. But, well, you know." "Know what?" I persisted, trying not to hint at the shame I was feeling for having balded her smell, or the grossly squishy way her hug felt. "Well..." The mare looked about furtively, then lowered her head, whispering, "You know what they're all like. Ticking time bombs, right? I mean, you can see what being a ghoul is doing to your outsides. Imagine what it's doing to their brains. They all go mad sooner or later. Dear Ditsy, she's lasted a good long time, and she's only a little crazy for it. But someday... I just don't want my boy to hurry that long, none. Or be there when she finally does turn on us all." With that, the mare drew herself up, pulling Trolley close, and hurried off. Away, notably, from absolutely everything.
What a bitch!
I stood there for a long time.
What a bitch!
Stunned.
Finally, sorry if I'm quiet, my roommate is asleep,
is
so...
Is that true? Calamity sighed deeply. It was not a good sign.
I would scream if I could.
Most of them, anyway. You get into the wrong places, you find yourselves hunted by whole packs of cannibal ghoul ponies gone zombie. But, and I mean this, that's only most of them. And even the good pony folk, if a little smelly and strange-looking, until that day. Some, like Ditsy-Doo, break the odds and never lose their noodle. I understood the spirit of the words, but the news didn't make me scared of the hairless Pegasus rider. It made me ache for her. Crane was a yellow unicorn pony with an orange and beige striped mane and tail. He wore a bright orange construction hat with a hole in it for his horn. When we found him, he was loading barrels onto the flatbed of a train car. This one actually still on the tracks that ran through town and connected to several others. "Howdy. Pleased to meet the little mare with the pit buck who saved Sweet Apple and Ditsy-Doo. Not to mention Desert Rose, Barrel Cactus, and Turquoise." He stopped to shake my hoof vigorously. "Pleased to meet you too," I smiled, feeling a touch wobbly after the hoofshake. "Railwright told me you're the pony to talk to if I wanted to see some heavy lifting." Crane smiled, then casually lifted three barrels at once, putting them in their places on the flatbed. "Reckon I am." Then, to my shock, he asked, "What kind of spells you got?" "Spells?" I replied hesitantly. "You know," he continued, talking while three more barrels levitated by, glowing with the same light as shone from his horn. "Unicorn ponies generally have a small collection of magical spells, usually related to what he or she is destined to be good at." Except for the ones that are destined to be good at spells, of course, because then they get a whole heap of them. Me, for instance. I can make all manner of repairs to the rails and trains just by focusing at them. Crap. Kicking a hoof of the ground, I sighed deeply. Nope. Just telekinesis. No spells. I knew it was pathetic. Levitation was basic Philly stuff. By the time I got my cutie mark, every other unicorn in Stable 2 had a nice collection of spells. Thank you, Crane, for reminding me that I was probably the most unmagical unicorn ever.
That's kind of messed up. Surprise. I'll be honest, but hey, you beat the odds. Lots of work to do. You're pretty well handy with that.
If y'all would do me a small favor, I'll return it by teaching you everything I know about heavy lifting. Sounded great to me. What's the favor? Fetch him a soda, maybe some lunch. Help tie down the barrels in the flatbed. We've been having a small bit of trouble with the things that have been crawling up out of that old stable west of here. From what I hear, y'all are my brave and ain't no slouch with slinging a firearm. Just get down to the stable and close the door. I reckon we can clear out the vomits up here if some pony locks off their breeding grounds. Okay, not a soda run. So, why are you with me again? The sky had darkened prematurely. I would soon have to turn on my lamp spell of my pit buck. I figured I owe you one, Calamity said earnestly as he followed beside me. Maybe a whole mess of ones, considering all the good you did for the good ponies in New Appaloosa. With a sigh, I tried to console him. You couldn't have known. I was wearing blood-caked raider armor, and carrying an arsenal that would make the average raider radioactive and envy. Caked in raider blood? Armor you only had because you needed protection while saving the lives of 5 good towns ponies. Only 4, really. Ditsy-Doo saved Sweet Apple. And you saved Ditsy-Doo so she could save Sweet Apple. In my book, that makes 5. He took a deep breath. Besides, I can't consent to you going down there alone. I've heard dark stories about those stables. Bad, bad things happen down there, and too many of them. I came from a stable. Hell, every pony came from some pony who came from a stable, right? I can see why an empty one would be an inviting nesting ground, but it's not like the stables are cursed or sinister. Calamity mulled that over. I suppose you're right about that. All except the few like Ditsy-Doo who somehow survived the apocalypse on the surface, or are descended from the folks who did. I halted my trot so abruptly I nearly fell over. My surviving canteen, refilled, swung out and back, smacking me in the chest.
Wait, Ditsy... what?
Ditsy-Doo survived the war? She's that old? Yep. Good ponies don't age like normal pony folk. The idea of a pony who had actually been around way back then, who actually knew what happened, blew my mind away. What's her story? Calamity snorted a laugh. So long I couldn't even guess the most of it. I do know she was flying outside Cloudsdale when the first mega spell hit it. She was caught at the very edge of the magical energies that wiped out the entire city. Been a ghoul ever since. I nodded, continuing on in my solemn silence. The image of an entire city in the clouds filled with Pegasus ponies played out in my head. There 1 minute, and then just nothing. The clouds above started to leak. It was like being in a shower back at Stable 2. Only the shower was everywhere, and it didn't stop. If I hadn't been cleaned by candy the day before, I would have welcomed it, despite the cold of the water. Now, soaked to the bone, I just found it miserable. The sky had turned so dark I had to turn on my pit buck's lamp spell to see ahead of me. In theory, it was still daylight, but that was hard to believe. A ferocious wind had picked up out of nowhere and was whipping the rain at us like a weapon. What's going on? I cried out to Calamity above the storm. It's a thunderstorm, and a mighty big one. We best be finding some shelter because it's getting started.
Man, that must be weird to never...
I hollered back as a patch of clouds lit up briefly, but brilliantly. What's thunder...
I actually have to point this out. This must be really weird for someone who's never experienced the outside. Seriously, I'm in it all the time. Seriously, I've fired weapons in the snow. It sucks. Oh, God. And I've rucked marched in a good drizzle, but I've also ran in the rain. It sucks really bad. At least earlier today that... Well, today for me, 2 days ago for you, that, hey, I had a decent weather for ruck marching, and, hey, but someone who's never experienced rain, that's a lot to me. Like, who doesn't experience rain? Like, everywhere in the world experiences rain except one place, and that's Antarctica.
under. Kaboom! The sky exploded. It was the sound of a gunshot, if the gun was wielded by Celestia herself, and made out of pure awesome. I actually tried hiding under Calamity. Get a pure hold awesome. Of yourself there! Timidly, and a little bashfully, I backed up and got on my hooves. Another flash illuminated the whole countryside in stark white and shadow, gone before I realized it had happened. Another mighty boom tore the sky, following close behind the flash. Calamity had to put his forehoofs on me to stop me from trying it again. If y'all are so scared of the thunder, wait till you actually see the lightning, he chuckled. Now let's get to moving so as we can find some shelter. Each flash of light in the clouds was followed by a terrifying crack or a mighty boom. A little later, I did indeed see the lightning. I'd been envisioning lightning bolts like those blasts of electricity like the brain bots had been shooting at me. This was nothing like that. This was a white tear through the sky, like the universe itself had been slashed open. It lasted an eye blink, but I still saw its afterimage floating in front of my face for several minutes later. I also saw some pony, or I thought I did, in the far distance on a hilltop, briefly illuminated by the lightning. I couldn't tell if it was a unicorn or a pegasus. At first, I thought it was both. But the vision was gone before I could be sure I had seen anything at all. We galloped, the ground beneath us increasingly muddy and treacherous, until we were forced to stop by a raging, frothy river. The muddy, rushing water was tearing away at the banks on each side. I could see the black shapes of uprooted dead trees as they were carried away. Just beyond the other side rose a cliff face. Water was pouring down the cracks of the cliff, 100 rivulets, each feeding into the river at the bottom. Across from us, just a little way up the cliff, was the dark mouth of a cave. The path up to it was already washed away. I stood there, staring helplessly, trying to figure out how we were going to get across. Then, I felt myself being lifted into the air as Calamity flew us over the river and set me down on the mouth of the cave, feeling quite stupid. I stepped further in, shining the lamp of my pit buck into the cave. The path continued up about a yard, then took a steep decline with frightfully old metal stairs, rusted nearly black, leading to a concrete landing. Once at the landing, the rough walls were replaced by stonework. At the end, a very familiar-looking steel door hung open on its hinge arm. The number 24 was emblazoned on the center of the door. Beyond lay a rusted, ruined doppelganger of the place I had once believed would forever be my home. Calamity rushed past me. Don't stand there gawking. Help me get this door shut before that damn river spills its banks completely and floods this hole. He was trying to push the door physically. I looked down, noticing for the first time that the floor of the cave was already a puddle, 2 inches deep and growing. Moved to action, I rushed to the controls. I paused long enough to check the bolting mechanism, which was actually entirely missing, and making sure I'd be able to open it again. Satisfied that I could, I tried to push up the lever, but it wouldn't budge. Focusing, my horn glowing brightly, I added my telekinetic strength to that of my hooves. With a loud, grinding sound, the lever moved. With a wheeze, the lever arm moved, and the door to Stable 24 slammed shut, groaning in protest. You realize we just shut ourselves into the evil, scary stable of spookiness, right? I teased my self-invited companion as he stared about the place in wonder. I'm trusting you're right about what you said earlier. Reckon if any pony knows better, it would be you. He shot me a nervous smile. Besides, he added, flapping his wings, not like these are gonna do me any good down here, one way or the other. My eyes caught the harness Calamity wore. The Pegasus had twin long-range rifles, one strapped to each side of his body, right under his wings, built into a saddle mechanism. Thin metal reins reached out in front of him, ending in a bit that hovered a few inches below his mouth. By biting on it, the sibling barrels would fire at once. The saddle was designed to reload on command, possibly triggered by pulling on the bit, or biting differently. I couldn't tell. Hey, Calamity, I've been meaning to ask you, what is that? I pointed a hoof at the contraption. What? He looked around, spinning in place. I couldn't suppress a laugh. He stopped looking at me, then back behind him again once more before. What do you mean, my battle saddle? I nodded. Fine piece of work, ain't it? I designed it myself. Saddle.
That's actually pretty cool.
Up, showing off proudly. Then, after my expression asked, you mean to tell me you ain't never seen a battle saddle before? I shook my head. Well, ain't that a thing? He strutted about. There's basically two types of firearms, loosely speaking. There's the small ones that the pony can stick in his mouth and levitate round if he's a unicorn. Then, there's battle saddles for all the firearms that are just too big and heavy to have, and too much kick-wielded without support. Now, I've seen all kinds of weapons built into battle saddles. Machine guns, rocket launchers. Rocket launchers? My tail drooped, and ears fell back at the thought. Yep. Even magic energy weapons. He paused. For those are so damn scarce, you're not likely to ever see one of them yourself. I filed that away for future reference. After checking my pip buck for radiation or similar dangers, and the EFS for any glows of hostility, I took a long gulp from my canteen and began plotting our course. I was confident from my lifetime in a stable that I could navigate this one with no problems. If the layout was the same, the door to the right in the next room should lead to the stairs headed downward. That would be the cafeteria, living quarters, school, and clinic. To the left, a corridor leading deeper into maintenance, including the ever-familiar pit buck technician maintenance stall. Without a second thought, I decided we'd go right first. Calamity, meanwhile, had scouted all the immediately adjacent rooms. He came back with a mildly surprised look. They got a box of dynamite in the storage room over yonder. Okay, that was a bit surprising.
Dynamite?
Set my ears stick up. You weren't going to find that in Stable 2. What was in it? Dynamite, I reckon, Clammy said, mock scholarly. In truth, I don't know for sure. It was locked, and I wasn't about to go shaking it like a birthday present to try and figure it out.
My back.
On the off chance it might be full of, you know, dynamite. I followed the rust-colored Pegasus back to the storage room to check it out. But after three tries and the loss of two more bobby pins, which I was beginning to run alarmingly low on, I had to admit the lock was beyond even my self-proclaimed expertise. Instead, I suggested we move on along the path I originally planned. The door to the living quarters slid open with a reassuring hiss. The lights gave off a familiar whine, those that still worked. Already, Stable 24 was making me horribly homesick. Worse, the dull ache in my heart mixed with the disconcerting sense of wrongness. Seeing this place in rust and ruins was unpleasant in a way that I couldn't describe. It was like walking through my own personalized version of the post-apocalypse. I was finding doors that wouldn't open. The floor was strewn with tin cans and litter. The generators, uncared for, were making an odd rhythmic churring. And, from deeper within came chugging, banging, and hissing sounds that had no place in a stable at all. This was a demoralizing, eerie, spook house version of Stable 2. I turned to look back at Calamity and caught him picking up bottle caps off the floor. I bit my lip, bracing against a wave of emotion that shrieked that he was desecrating this place. Looting and scavenging was survival out in the equestrian wasteland, and, logically, that applied to here, too. But, even more than stripping goods off of fresh corpses, this felt like grave robbing. Unholy. My feelings scattered as, overhead, a burst of thunder hit so close to the cave that we could hear it inside the stable. My heart thumped in my chest. What the hell? I stammered, waving my forehoofs to indicate the sky outside. I told you, thunderstorm. That isn't like any storm I've read about in my textbooks, I encountered. Calamity looked at me with a softly mocking expression. Weather ain't like it used to be. The sun and mood ain't guided through the sky by ponies anymore. We Pegasus. The goddesses Celestia and Luna move the sun and the moon through the sky each and every day, I shot back, scandalized. How could he even say that? That was like blasphemy. Oh yeah, he rolled his eyes at me. Rolled his eyes at me. From their place in pony heaven. Right. I bristled. He stared quietly till I gave in, motioning for him to continue. As I was saying, we Pegasus ain't around scheduling the weather, neither. Equestria's weather's gone wild. I felt a chill down my mane. Through the metal walls on the mountain, we felt the percussion of the storm. I had begun to wonder how over-engineered Stable 2 must have been for me to have never heard of storms like these. Obviously, it was designed to stay closed longer, which I was figuring probably accounted for other architectural differences I had started to notice. Huh, I thought out loud. There's only one section of bathrooms. At least, only one in the living quarters section of the stable. Back in Stable 2, there were two. One for mares, one for stallions. The floor outside was wet, and I could hear a roar, gurgling, splashing sounds from behind the bathroom door. Also, unlike Stable 2, Stable 24 was connected to the aquifer, its water supply merely purified with antitoxin and anti-radiation spells. With the downpour outside, every sink and toilet was backing up. The same went for the water fountains. The one between the school and the living quarters was spraying brown water. The horrible noises were coming from the pipes and plumbing rather than unnatural monsters. I stopped dead as a red spot flashed up on my compass of my EFS. Somewhere, just ahead of us, was surely one of the creatures Crane had talked about. Not, I realized, that either of us had bothered to get a description. So, any idea exactly what sort of varmints we're supposed to be looking for down here? I whispered as we both crouched down, moving as stealthily as possible. While bathrooms weren't segregated, sleeping areas were. The main floor for stallions, and a lower one for mares. That, too, was different than Stable 2, where the quarters were geared towards families. My EFS felt annoyingly limited, unable to tell me which level the creature was on, just that it was almost dead ahead now. I levitated out little Macintosh, ready as I could be. Actually, no, Calamity whispered back. And I recall, we ain't supposed to be looking for 'em. We're supposed to just close the door. As I recall, I retorted, maybe a slight bit less quietly than I should have, I'm supposed to be closing the door. You weren't supposed to be anywhere. I couldn't deny that he had a point. In fact, if trapped inside a creature's lair,
I hit the mic.
Poking around was probably the dumbest thing a pony could possibly do. On the other hoof, this was another stable. My curiosity and sense of connection wouldn't allow me to leave it unexplored. And if I was trapped in here for a few hours, well, no time like the present. Calamity shook his head, but followed all the same. We moved a few steps closer, and the red spot winked out. I turned quickly, trying to see if it had somehow gotten behind us, but there was nothing. Either the creature had evaporated, or we were right on top of it, one floor up. We crouched there, keeping still and quiet. After a moment, the red spot appeared again, once more right in front of us. And a few seconds later, it vanished once more. This time, apparently, for good. Aside from age and deterioration, the school in Stable 24 looked exactly like the one back home. Students' tables, all in nice little rows. A sharing area with toys. The teacher's desk, with a terminal, pencils, and even a long rotted apple. The only real difference was a large glass tank, which could have once been an aquarium. Even with rusted walls, this felt like home. It should have been comforting. Instead, it was unpleasantly weird, and it was putting me on edge. The constant banging and screaming of the pipes was adding to my discomfort and giving me a mild headache for good measure. Worst of all...
What I'm getting at this... Unless acting, I keep hitting the mic. I can understand the homesickness, because I'm in this. I'm stuck here in these barracks, and I miss home. Yeah, I miss it. I understand this. Can you imagine I'd be able to go home? Because I can't go home unless I get a chance to. Like, I won't be able to go home until, like, June. So, yeah. And, I guess that's all I can say about that, is that I can understand Pip's problem here. So, here we go.
We'd encountered three more ghosts, hostile entities that appear in my eyes forward sparkle, but nowhere else. A matter not at all helped by the fact that Calamity had no pip buck of his own, so he couldn't tell what I was reacting to. I was beginning to worry that my eyes forward sparkle, or even my pip buck itself, had been damaged or warped by exposure to the wasteland. Unlikely, I reassured myself, remembering that they were made to withstand much worse than this. What was more likely, and less comforting, was that the creatures down here had magic of their own. You ever heard of any pony named Prince Celeste? What? I trotted over, brow furrowing. Let me see that, I said, snatching the book from the desk in front of him with a glow of telekinesis.
Prince Celeste?
I read a few sentences, then slammed the book shut to look at the cover. It was a children's storybook. The Stallion on the Moon? Calamity chuckled. You know, I think I remember my ma reading a story like that. Only it was a mare in the moon, if I recollect. That's because it's supposed to be the mare on the moon. Quickly, I began looking through the other books on the desks and school shelves. When I was done, I had reached important feeling observations. One, every significant pony in every book had been changed into a stallion. Well, I suspect some of them were stallions to begin with. Two, I continued undaunted, even though my voice sounded strained even my own ears. Not one story or textbook has anything but the vaguest references to the history or governance of Equestria.
Not that Stable 2's libraries were stellar in that regard. The most recent history in any of our textbooks was over a generation old. But this here wasn't a lack of material. This was a deliberate alteration of facts and context. In the portion of the stable dedicated to education, this was... it was... You know, you're gonna burst something if you don't calm down a touch. I tossed the book I was holding into a corner with malice. I was about to trot
that is,
out.
Oh my god.
Wrapped about me like a cobra. Remembered the terminal sitting on the teacher's desk.
Oh man, that's another thing that ticks me off. It's propaganda, you know. Ever heard the phrase that whoever wins the war writes the history books? In this case, there's no war or anybody to stop this guy, so he basically, or whoever did this, was obviously very sexist and was really down against Mare, so he decided to make everything a stallion, I guess. That's my opinion of what's happening here, and that's really, really fucked up. Like, saying it's Prince Celeste instead of Princess Celestia, that is... Well, technically, I guess you could say they're the gods of their world, but that's, like, blasphemy, literal blasphemy in, and, oh my god, I don't even know how to respond to that, holy shit. We're only over 30 minutes into the video, it is a video, but it's an audio recording, but seriously.
The screen was giving off a soft glow. I trotted over and prepared to hack into it, only to be slightly disappointed when it offered up its secrets so readily. Such as they were, there were entries mainly filled with notes on attendance and grades. Two stuck out, though. First, I had a real surprise when we tested the young unicorns on their magic today. I had all my little ponies bring in their pets and show me how they could make them levitate. Simple enough, although a squirming animal can add a level of difficulty for foals at this age. I had to let both Butter and Paradence each borrow the class mascot, since neither have a pet of their own. Paradence was thrilled, but I think Butter is terrified of the snake, although she's been told it's defanged and harmless. Needless to say, Butter didn't do very well. The real surprise was little Quanta, who has been struggling with even minor levitation all year. Now, I know these things have never been recorded in girls, but I can't imagine any other explanation. We had a full magical epiphany occur right in our classroom. Quanta not only levitated herself, but she let out a flash of energy that affected all the pets in the room. Most just panicked and had to be recovered, but some, including our mascot, seemed to have vanished completely. And strangest of all, the arcane flash seems to have turned Carrot Tail's ugly old cat into, well, an even uglier old cat. It only lasted a moment. Quanta seems fine. Didn't even realize what she'd done. Of course, parents had to be called, and Carrot Tail was traumatized. It'll be a miracle if I can teach these foals anything for the rest of the week. Meanwhile, I'm going to write up a proposal to have another unicorn stallion watch over these tests from now on, just as a precaution. The second entry that stuck out was 4 days later, and it was from the last entry on the terminal. I expected a few parents to keep their colts and fillies home after the excitement at the beginning of the week, but by now, they should be letting them back. Instead, attendance is at its lowest yet. Over half of my students have skipped their classes today. If things haven't turned around by the end of the week, I'm going to start calling parents. And if that doesn't work, maybe even the overstallion. I stared at the last entry for a while. Wait, the overstallion? Clammy looked at me curiously. What's wrong? This overmare of the stable was an overstallion. He blinked, and then his eyes narrowed just a little. Now what's wrong with that? The overmare is supposed to be an overmare. That's what's wrong. It was like explaining to a child, but instead of understanding,
I honestly think that's a bit sexist. In opinion,
y'all saying a fella can't do what a gal can do. Taken aback suddenly, no, it's not that at all. I waved my hooves in negation. It's just the way it's supposed to be. It's tradition. He didn't move. His voice was very even. You're saying that even if there was a fella who was better at leading a stable than any other pony, stallion or mare, and had the cutie mark to show for it and everything, that he wouldn't be allowed on account he was a buck. I gulped, taking a step back. Damn it, but I was right. There was nothing I could say to explain that I was right without digging myself deeper. So instead, I just clammed up and said nothing. Calamity turned and walked out of the classroom. This time, I followed him.
Okay, now I do feel a mite bit embarrassed. In front of us was another door to maintenance. To our right, the cafeteria. To our left, a maintenance storeroom. In the storeroom, a glowing terminal, several shelves of supplies, and a poster on the wall of a mighty stallion standing brave and tall, facing danger head-on, ready and able, with three mares crouched down at his hind hooves, frightened but looking up to him for salvation, adoration evident in their eyes. Calamity felt embarrassed. I felt something creeping more towards anger. It wasn't that this turn should have taken us towards the atrium. I could forgive a severe divergence in stable design, although it did irk me. It wasn't the heroic stallion, or the simpering mares. There's a desire to be special and be admired for your accomplishments that the poster played to, which I fully understood. It wasn't even about that this was the fifth poster we'd come across, and all of them catered to the same gender bias. It was that the stallion in the picture was valiantly holding a wrench in his teeth, and the unspeakable horror that had the girl ponies all cringing like frightened bunnies was apparently a leaky sink. Carefully, so as not to step on another social mine. What? Do you see why I'm upset? This isn't like, give it to the best pony, who cares about tradition. This is... Yep, this is manipulation. All these posters been here since before ponies trotted up to this stable to avoid the apocalypse. He turned and fixed me with a look. It's like saying their jobs only fit either a mare or a stallion. I got the point. And that's only true for cooking. I stopped. My ears shot up for a moment. I bet they could have been steaming. What? What's that supposed to... And then I caught his sly look. Oh, ha-ha, I guess I deserve that. Yep. We were quiet a moment. I turned to the storeroom terminal and read over the logs of a pony who appeared to be the maintenance supervisor while Calamity hoof-picked some supplies worth scavenging. The clanging and banging of the pipes...
Also, that cooking...
But for a moment...
God, this is really ticking me off, honestly. Calamity almost got me with that that cooking thing, because I'm a cook. My job is to cook. Seriously, that is my occupation. I am designed to cook for hungry soldiers, and that is, I am meant to cook hungry soldiers for hungry soldiers in the field. But it's a good thing Calamity was joking. I'm glad Calamity was joking. Because I would have got ticked off, and Calamity would be on my hate list. And I have to be honest. You know, you have to think about it. There's a kind of a gender swap switch in this universe. Like, if you think about it, you know, the show was designed for little girls, after all, and they don't have very many males. They're always depicted, and they are always depicted either evil, dumb, or... If they're not the main character, they're either evil or dumb, if you never notice. Like there's only a few characters who aren't dumb in My Little Pony, such as Big McIntosh and Shining Armor. And there's only a few. So, but on a serious note, this is this is actually kind of pointing out the fun in that. If you think about it, I don't know if Kit Kat, you pointed this out. You meant to point this out, but I actually see it. Because in the old days, it was always, you know, the male was dominant, and they always believed in that each gender had their own role. Some people still believe that, which is kind of wrong, but seriously. Like, it's kind of the flip-flop thing, you know? Like, only a president can be male thing. That's kind of like it used to be, I think that used to be a thing. And I'm guessing this is kind of the same thing as an overmare. Oh my god, my blisters. man. Anyway, I'm rambling on this. Like, I'll be honest, sexism is not something I really appreciate. Like, on both ends. For both ends in general. I don't believe in double standards. So.
I felt a little less stressed. I felt that I had just made it out of the social minefield. Singed, but intact. So, naturally, that was the moment everything went to hell. I had just finished the fourth entry and was partway through the final entry when my EFS flared up, with not one ghost, but five. Entry 1. I cannot believe my luck. Persimony is one fine mare. The date last night went incredibly well. She even let me kiss her. And her little filly, Carrot Tail, seems to like me too. Even better, I kinda like her. I don't have to pretend like I thought I would just spend some more time with her mother. In fact, we have a second date planned tomorrow night. Oh, and Greyhorn finally fixed the lighting on level 2B. That flickering was driving every pony bonkers. Entry 2. Damn it, of all the luck. First, the whole lighting strip on guess which level blows out, plunging the damned atrium into blackness in the middle of a rush. Even worse, Persimony postponed our date. Some unicorn filly did something wonky to Carrot Tail's pet, and Persimony's been with her all day trying to keep the little cunt from drowning in her own tears. Take it back. I hate children. Entry 3. Got called to the Overstallion's office today. Big emergency that required my special talents. Any guesses? Locked himself out. Again. Again. This is the third time this week. Fortunately...
Okay, man, these heavy words. Oh, God. I'll be honest. Whoa, I did not expect that to come out of that guy's mouth like that. Oh, God. Oh, God. This story is not meant for little kids at all.
Any pony with half a lick of sense could get that thing open. Weakest damn lock I've ever seen. Still, just in case Greyhorn ever has to do it, I left a handful of bobby pins and a copy of today's locksmith in the maintenance locker room safe. I've even highlighted the most useful bits for him. So as long as he doesn't forget the password, even he shouldn't have a problem. And I made the password his name, so... Ah, hell, he'll probably forget it still. Meanwhile, my love life's taken a turn for the worse. Persimony's filly's apparently in the clinic. I hear the cat attacked her. Probably had to put it down. Entry 4. Where the hell is Greyhorn? Idiot missed his whole damn shift today. Called up to his room, but no answer. God damn it, I gotta do everything around here myself, don't I? Oh, I replaced the entire lighting assembly up on level 2B. And guess what?
Wait a minute.
We're still having problems. I swear to God, the ponies who built this place must have been cutting corners. Probably cheated Stable Tech out of fat loads of money. Hope their asses melted when the mega spells hit.
Wait a minute.
Entry 5.
That spell that a girl made.
Talked with some others, and they haven't seen him either. Suggested a check medical. Would be just like him to find a way to fall and impale himself on his own horn. Damn it, there's that scratching sound again. Something's managed to get into the ventilation system. I've removed several of the covers on this floor. Hopefully whatever it is will fall out and I won't have to send some colt crawling in after it. Did I mention how much I hate children? Double damn it. I just spotted the thing staring down at me. If I didn't know better, I'd say it was Carrot Tail's damn cat. But they caught him and put it down yesterday. Triple damn it. Damn thing just bit me. I swear, I'm gonna send a colt up there after it with a flamethrower. Looking up, I saw the dark opening where the covering grate should have been, and several pairs of alien eyes gleaming at me. Calamity, get back! They're in the ventilation! Calamity backed away at my shout, even as the first creature leapt out, landing on the shelving, spilling
what
a
is
bunch
it?
Of fuses, crashing to the floor.
I know it's the pets!
It looked only vaguely feline, but with scales rather than fur, oversized fangs and cat-like eyes, save that the slits ran horizontally. Somehow, that last part freaked me out the most. I had made the mistake of putting little Macintosh away. When it leapt at me, I didn't have the time to draw the gun out, or even think. I reacted instinctually, grabbing the creature telekinetically and hurling it away from me, just like with the grenade. Only this time, we were in a small room, and there was no place for it to go. So, instead, it just thumped back against the wall, pinned and hissing. A second jumped out, hitting the terminal, and fell to the floor. I raised a hind hoof and brought it down as hard as I could on the creature's head. Rearing up, I treated the one I was pinning to a fatal blow from one of my forehooves. The third jumped right down onto me, claws catching in my mane. I screamed like a little filly. Get it off, get it off, get it off, get it off! I bucked, panicking, sending a hind hoof to the top with a crunching.
I'll be honest, that's kind of funny.
I could feel the hairs around my hoofs.
I'm not... I know I said some shit about being... about sexism, but I've noticed this a lot, that everybody... That a lot of females really like with spiders, like, get off. Yet again, there are some guys I know, pause, who will, act like that.
Singed. turned towards the doorway and saw Calamity taking aim. Blam! My mind conjured up a flashback of being wounded and dying, shot multiple times by this very same pony who was swooping down the tracks, aiming at me again. Without thinking, I threw myself to the floor, trying to dodge the shot. A second after Calamity had already fired, ripping the cat snake thing apart,
and leaving
me unscathed. I got up on my hooves, wobbly, but unhurt. I tried to smile, although I could feel it was more like a grimace. I could read it in his face. He wanted to tell me I should just trust him, to tell me to stop being afraid he was going to shoot me. But he wasn't going to. He couldn't, because he knew I had every right and reason to be gun-shy around him, that I should be acting this way. In that moment, I realized something. He was actually sorry he shot me. Not sorry he had shot the new local hero who had saved some townsfolk, but sorry he had shot me. He wasn't here out of embarrassment. He was trying to fix some loss of reputation or standing, either in his eyes or anybody else's. He really felt regretful that I had nearly died. I didn't even realize I was thinking about him that way, but now I realized I had been. Damn it, now I felt like I should be apologizing to him. He turned away, looking up at the ceiling. I figured the sound of the shots scare him off. For now, I agreed. I had my revelation, but I couldn't tell him. He'd just deny it, and then there'd be awkwardness. He was a boy, after all. Damn it. I scolded myself for having such a thought. Not that it was hard to figure out what had me thinking like that.
Wait,
I glared at that stupid poster. I hate this stable. Little Macintosh whipped around, firing off three more SATS guided shots. Three more of the evil little cat snake things were blown into oblivion. They were easy to kill, which hardly made up for being so fast, small, and agile. And, not to mention, extremely aggressive. Several more tried to jump onto Calamity, finding purchase with their claws. He bucked, throwing back his wings, sending them flying, and buck-kicked one of the fallen ones into a reddish paste. How many of these little monsters you reckon we got? I fired at one of the creatures Calamity had thrown, missing, and again hitting this time. The last got by me, leaping for Calamity's back. I heard him howl as the creature sunk its teeth into the back of his neck. Don't worry, I got it. I wrenched the creature away telepathically, my horn glowing fiercely as it brought little Macintosh up to the mewling thing, dripping Calamity's blood, and pulled the trigger. Damn, those things got a bite. Hold still, let me look. I was already pulling out medical bandages out of my saddlebag. I was nearly out of those. I knew we could get some in either the clinic, which should be ahead, or in the living quarters bathroom, which would mean a lot of backtracking. We had gone through maintenance, a trip that had been a long, wet, but uneventful slog through the lowest part of the stable, which was half filled with water. We'd found the locker room, and with the password, we'd opened the safe. My bobby pin collection was now far more comfortable, and today's locksmith had been tucked neatly in my saddlebags. The only creatures we had found in maintenance were dead, drowned. Despite looking like a cross between a serpent and a cat, the little monsters didn't seem to be able to swim. Thank the wasteland for small favors when you can get them. We did, however, start finding skeletons. Sporadically at first, and now in groups. The closer we got to the atrium, the heart of the stable, the more death we found. I couldn't hold back the image of someone walking through stable 2 and finding the bodies of everyone I had known for all but the last few days of my life dead like this. For a moment, it was too much. I had to rest, to clear my head. No less than 9 of the damn things chose that moment to attack us. Wrapping Calamity's wound, I grimaced at my lack of medical skill. If I tried to join the Ministry of Peace, they'd kick me out of my tail. It was bad enough when only I would die if I didn't know the right end of a potion bottle. I really didn't like having any pony else relying on me and my lack of skill. Still, we were up and moving in the right direction. Except we really weren't, were we? The more I thought about it, the less reasonable my reasons for wandering around down here seemed. Finishing, I turned away and looked back down the way we came. Okay, now that's it. I've been a dumb pony. We turn around, gallop back to the entrance as fast as we can, barricade ourselves, and wait the damn storm out. Then, we leave and close the door behind us. Actually, I vote we continue to the clinic. I turned, surprised. Seeing Calamity made my surprise turn to shock, then horror. I'm guessing, y'all, he teetered, looking pale beneath his coat, would keep something there for, you know, poison? Thump. Down went the Pegasus. Calamity! Chimera. From the personal notes of Dr. Briarberry, head of medicine, Stable 22.
Chimeras!
I've chosen to call this new species Chimera for what I feel was a suitably obvious reason. The creature is the result of a wild magical burst from a rather exceptionally gifted filly named Quanta. In a flash of uncontrolled magical power, Quanta managed to fuse several creatures within her vicinity into a single being, a fully functional and completely new life form. The initially created Chimera took several days to molt before revealing its true nature, during which time another filthy, Carrot Tail, was attacked by the creature. She was rushed to the clinic, but perished within hours from an unknown magical toxin injected into the child by the creature. After molting, the Chimera subsequently attacked a maintenance worker by the name of Greyhorn. This time, both the Chimera and its victim were fully mature. Based on the case of Carrot Tail, we treated Greyhorn with anti-venom spells and potions, but to no avail. Greyhorn lasted three times as long as Carrot Tail, and was in extreme agony for most of that period. It was only after Greyhorn's death that we learned the key component of the Chimera's makeup. As you will be able to see from the images I am having attached to this document, the feline and serpentine elements of the fusion are quite obvious. See images C1 and C2. What we initially did not realize, couldn't have suspected, is that there had been another manner of insect in the classroom when Ro had cast her spell, and that too was infused into the creature on a deeply inherent level. You see, the fangs of the Chimera aren't so much like the fangs of a rattlesnake, but more akin to an insect's ovipositor. The behavior of this species is extremely aggressive, attacking any suitable host within which it can inject its eggs. Over the course of a single day, those eggs will mature within the host, after which a litter of new baby Chimera will dig their way out of the infected pony, ultimately killing the host if the pony was not already dead. In the case of Greyhorn, 5 new Chimera erupted from his body less than an hour after he was pronounced dead. See images C3. You can imagine the look on my assistant's face, but you don't have to. See image C4. Fortunately, from the case of Greyhorn and the baby Chimera specimens he provided us with, we have been able to devise and conjure an anti-Chimera potion. Unfortunately, some of the herbs acquired were in tragically short supply, so there is a high probability that we will not have sufficient quantities for everyone. The Overstallion is keeping one bottle locked away in his office, along with the recipe. Meanwhile, I am storing the rest of this in the medical refrigerator here in the clinic while I wait for the Overstallion's decision on how to implement the dispersal. Oh, Celestia, have mercy. By the time I was done reading, horror turned me numb. Slowly, I got up from Dr. Briarberry's terminal and stared about the clinic. There were pony skeletons everywhere, dozens of them surging towards the open door of the medical fridge. Others were entangled around each other. A new species, extremely hostile, which renders its victim immobile with a single bite, and then tortures them to death from inside over most of a day. And, in doing so, can quintuple its number. I swiftly realized the only thing that had kept the Chimera from overrunning the equestrian wasteland was the river and the fact that these Chimera can't swim. Thank the wasteland for huge favors. If we survived this, I was going to have a little talk with Crane about his definition of a small bit of trouble. Understatement was not a virtue in the equestrian wasteland. I looked at the bed Calamity was resting on, looking even weaker than before. Oh, goddess. I couldn't tell him this. Let him think he's poisoned. It's so much better than this. Pointlessly, I stepped over and swung back to the door of the fridge, already knowing I would find nothing inside. Okay, one last shot. I walked to the clinic window and looked out into the atrium. The room was dark. Every light in it had failed. The only illumination came from the couple still functional lights in the clinic and the stuttering, flickering light from the circular window in the Overstallion's office above. If there was a single dose of the antidote left, it would be locked away in a safe up there. The only way to get to it was through the atrium. The atrium was teeming with Chimera, unfortunately. Swallowing hard, I turned to Calamity and told him the plan. After staring at me for a long time, Calamity finally said, "That's insane!" I focused, my horn beginning to glow, and slipped open my saddlebag. "I'll be okay." "No, you won't. That's suicide. And y'all be killing the both of us then." I looked at him sternly. "But let me guess, you're thinking you should do it yourself, seeing as how you're already poisoned. Never mind that you can't even stand up without help, and barely with it." The rust-colored Pegasus managed to look cross. "Then get yourself out of here. At least one of us will survive this crazy stable." Now I got to play cross. I am not leaving my friend behind. I reloaded Little Macintosh. Calamity coughed. He looked at me with genuine astonishment. Friend? But I shot you. I rolled my eyes at him and nodded. Yes, you did. And I'm planning to needle you about that for the rest of your life. And I'm sure not going to get my blood's worth if you die today. Don't be a stubborn fool, little Pip. There's no way in tarnation you can possibly. Levitating the stealth bike up for Calamity to see, I smiled with a whole lot more confidence than I felt. I do have this. It was, without questioning, the most harrowing 2 hours of my life. Inching my way through the darkness, surrounded by lethal predators, they couldn't see me, but in the darkness, it was only by my EFS and targeting spell that I was able to keep from stepping on or brushing against one of them. It was a minefield. And as I crossed, I realized just how calling my own stupidity a social minefield did flippant injustice to an actual minefield, and anyone who'd ever been caught in one. This was a minefield, and all the mines were alive and moving. One wrong move, and it wasn't just I who would die for it. But I did make it. And for once, the wasteland was pouring out the favors. The Overstallion's door was an easy pick, as advertised. From the skeleton, I guessed the Overstallion had locked himself in, and I feared he had consumed the anti-chimera potion. But within his locked safe, I found both it and the recipe, as well as an old recording. My guess was that it was his last words. If it had been stable too, and I had been the Overmare, watching everyone die because of some magical accident, I suspect I might have done the same. I took all three items. I figured I should, considering what I was going to do next. Even after drinking the remedy, Calamity was going to take some time to recover. There was no way to know how long it would take. Lifting both the Pegasus and Little Macintosh, I followed my path back, all too aware that the damn Chimera were using the ventilation, and that even cleared areas were not to be trusted. I made it all the way back to the storage room near the main door. Sitting down with today's locksmith, I went through, finding all the tips I could in a short amount of time. The highlighting really helped. Outside, Thunder shook the mountain reassuringly. I looked up and thanked Celestia for the storm. The tips from the book proved useful. With a bit of effort and only one bobby pin, I was able to get to the box marked dynamite. Inside, there was indeed dynamite. I removed each stick gingerly, then placed a curled up Calamity into the box, closing it. Should a chimera come for him while I was busy, I didn't want it to be able to get at him. For the next few hours, I ran back through the entirety of Stable 24, everything but the atrium. I opened each door that could be opened, and then blocked it with a trash can, or tipped over a filing cabinet, or anything else that would keep the door from closing. As for the atrium, after looting the clinic for medical supplies, I left a stick of burning dynamite on the windowsill of the clinic and ran. The rest of the dynamite was to blow the cave opening enough just to bring the river pouring in. By the time I was ready to set that off, Calamity had gotten up and wondered why he was packaged as high explosive. His eyes got wider and wider as I explained what I was doing. Damn! That was all. We'd been down in Stable 24 for most of the night. It was dawn by the time we returned to New Appaloosa. At least, in theory. The storm had stopped pounding the crap out of the wasteland, and was now content to just rain on us. Candy was kind enough to let me crash on one of her unused beds in the clinic. More than fair payment for giving her the anti-chimera cure. One copy of it, that is. It was still raining after I woke up, later in the afternoon. And it was late evening before Calamity had woken up and trotted out to join me. By then, I had finally been making some progress under Crane's tutelage. I was panting and sweating heavily as we stopped for a Sparkle Cola break. I say we're even, I told Calamity as Crane's floated an ice-cold Sparkle Cola over for each of us. I don't understand. If we'd just stayed put at the door, you would never have been bitten. If we'd stayed at the door, you never would have gotten the antidote. If we'd stayed put, you never would have needed it. Aha! But some pony else might. Crane said they'd been having trouble with the critters, so obviously some of them had to be getting out. Crap. I'd forgotten all about that. Still, with luck, and with their nest destroyed. It wasn't your stable, you know. Calamity's voice had taken a solemn quality. I looked at my new friend. What? I know you grew up in a stable, but it wasn't that stable. Of course it wasn't. I knew that, but I still wasn't sure what Calamity was getting at. It's just... You seem to be taking what we found down there. I don't know. Personally. He looked at me earnestly. I just wanted to remind you that. That's all. He was right, of course. I don't know what I was looking for, or I had expected to find, but I'd let Stable 24 become a personal affront. Stable 24 had never been my home. I had no relation to it at all. The only threads connecting the different stables were 200 years old, dead, and buried in a history mostly forgotten. Stable Tech hadn't existed in a long, long time. I had no allegiance to it, and the long dead couldn't bear any responsibility to me. Oh. I pulled out the recording from the Overstallion's office. Should we hear what's on it?
Wow. Wow, that was a pretty long chapter. Never thought I'd take this long on one of these recordings, but I do plan to do like every chapter I can get and subchapters that I've checked, by the way. There was like a lot of chapters. Dang, K-Cat. Dang. Oh, wow, my God. I actually need to go to bed because right now it's almost 2 in the morning for me, so. And I don't have work tomorrow, so that's the plus. So, anyway, guys, I hope you guys enjoy this. And, I have to bring this up again. K-Cat, I can't believe I didn't realize this beforehand. Because I knew your name seemed familiar, but I couldn't remember where I heard it before. And now I know! Oh, God, I feel so dumb. Well, forgive me, K-Cat, please. Oh, my God. Anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed this blind commentary, and I hope I'll see you guys in the next video. So, stay nerdy, my friends. Bye-bye!